Good morning and welcome to Orchard Beach Assembly today, whether you're here in person or whether you're joining us online. Isn't it so good to get together and be encouraged by each other in our walk with the Lord and just life? And I'm excited this morning to sing with you all and minister to the Lord and be able to receive encouragement and teaching from the Word. So are you excited? Go ahead and stand up and join us as we sing.
Song, if you believe he's risen, say amen. Amen. You know, that means he's alive and he's available and he's at our side and he's for us and he's not against us. We are blessed. Great to see everybody in the house of the Lord today. As you can see, this week we decided we're trying to avoid trying to go to the two services again because we just don't have the people resources with people still being safe. So we're opened up the two middle sections, and then the two side sections still have every other row there. So we just trust that you all make wise choices that meet your own needs. We do encourage you, if you're able, to try to wear a mask. We understand there's reasons why some can't. So just be aware of all that. But a lot of good things that are going on. How many had a great week? Three people. No. You know, sometimes they're good, sometimes they're not, but I tell you what, coming back to the house of the Lord and getting in his presence through worship, get of our minds off of ourselves and on him, makes all the world a difference. And we encourage you to do that as we go forward in worship. If you're a first time here today, we encourage you to grab your Connect card and your bulletin. We just ask that you fill that out, drop it off in a bucket on your way out after the service. And also, if it's your first time, stop by the welcome table. We have a gift just to say thanks for coming, because we really do appreciate you taking the step to check out a church if it's your first time. We have a gift just to say thanks for doing that. So be aware of that. Just one announcement, but make sure you check your bulletin. There's a lot of things going on, but youth group, they decided to have t-shirts made for all the youth workers, and we decided, you know what, I bet you there's a lot of parents and there's probably a lot of church members that would also like to show support to the youth ministry. So they're available to everybody in the lobby today. They're $10 each. We don't make any money off of it, but they're $10 each, and it's a good way for us to advertise to the community what God's doing at Orchard Beach, so just be aware of that. We're going to continue singing together, encourage you from your heart to his heart, share your words to him that way. Let's stand together.
Shall fill my heart, then I shall
don't have to conjure up reasons to worship you, Father. You are full of them. Hope for the here and now, and I really believe that we need to hear that it's not just the hope for the future, but it's the hope for the here and now. So church, whether it's your family that needs hope, whether it's your marriage that needs hope, whether it's your teenagers that need hope, you all need hope, right? We all do. Whether it's your employment, whether it's your financial situation, whether it's your health, whether it's your mental health, we all need hope. Just here to remind you this morning that Jesus is that hope. Let's cling to him. So let's sing this part again and just proclaim it. He's our living hope. He's not just the hope for the future, but the hope for the here and now. Let's see how this ends.
Out of the sun.
Hi. this part, let's declare it.
You're never gonna let me down.
Do you believe it this morning?
You're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. Lord, you're never gonna let me down.
We trust in you, Lord.
Let's finish by singing this morning.
Then sings my soul.
Presence that we come today. You are the King of Kings and the Lord of all Lords. As your head is bowed, I was thinking in that song, that one line, the King of my heart, let him be the fountain that I drink from. When I'm dry and thirsty, hurting and feel hopeless, I take a drink, and oh, you're good. When I'm lost and I don't know what to do, I take a drink, lift our voices to you and you alone. It's to you that we are surrendered and give our life to. You are worthy to be praised and to be followed with everything that we've got. Pray you'd bless my brothers and my sisters today as we gather in your house. Encourage them, build their faith, comfort them, and strengthen them. I ask in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. You may be seated. Wow, God is good. God is good. Well, today is an exciting day. We get to introduce to you 16 new official members of Orchard Beach Assembly. So we're excited about that. If our board members right now, would you would come and your wives come up on the platform if you'd come quickly. And then I'm going to list off the names. And as I mentioned your name, if you would come when I do that. But first, as they come, I just wanted to point out, you know, never have I ever experienced a time like I do now, like we all do right now, where it seems like the value of the church, it's the first time it seems like people used to value, even unbelievers would value and honor people that went to church. There was a respect for churchgoers. This is the first time I can think of in our culture where that is less and less. It is valued less and less. And these people that are becoming official members today are going against the current and saying, no, not for me in my house. We are committed to Jesus Christ. We're committed to the Lord's house. We believe his word is foundational to all that we do, and we want to commit ourselves. So just like water baptism is a public expression of commitment to Christ, membership is a public commitment to the body of Christ, the church. And so I'd like you to welcome with me to the platform today our good brother and sister Brian and Terry Bensick. Would you come on up? John and Deanna Carls, Brian and Heather Chess, Jeff and Dee Dee Fox, Dan and Julie Giebel, Ed and Val Heinrich, Liz Hunt, June Peterson, and Dan and Becky Steves. I think they told me they might not be able to make it today. You could just line up maybe in front of the board here if you would. My mic is not working. I'm using this, okay. I'm taking it off then, okay. Thank you. So this is a special time, and it's a powerful moment to make a public commitment to you, the body, brothers and sisters. And I'm just going to walk you through. We do a three-hour membership course. We talk about our statements of faith, our strategy, our leadership structure, and so forth. And at the end, they all literally sign a covenant, a promise to the body. And as I read these at the end of each, if you would all just say, I will, we'll go that way. And these are the four commitments that they have made. Will you protect the unity of my, I will protect the unity of my church by acting in love toward other members, by refusing to gossip, and by following the leaders. You just say, I will. Will you share the responsibilities of your church by praying for its growth, by inviting the unchurched to our environments, and by warmly welcoming those who visit? And will you serve the ministries of the church by discovering your gifts and talents, by being equipped to serve by your pastors, and by joining a ministry team? And will you support the vision and testimony of your church by attending faithfully, by living a godly life, and by giving regularly as God enables you? I will. Powerful. We love you guys. We love you guys. We're thankful that you're becoming part of the body here at Orchard Beach. We really are. We're excited what God is doing as he's bringing more people together to help build his kingdom. As brothers and sisters using our gifts together, we can influence more for the sake of our Savior, Jesus Christ. So I want to ask if you would just stand and pray over them with me, if you would. Board, if you would, and wives, put a hand on their shoulder behind them. And let's pray together. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we are thankful and grateful for what you're doing in the lives of these individuals, these couples, these individuals. We thank you, Lord, that you are building your church as you promised that you would. We thank you for the gifts and talents that are represented on this platform, that you are mobilizing for your work. We thank you, Lord, for their families, their children, and ask your blessings over them. And we pray now in the name of Jesus for your Holy Spirit's infilling, your Holy Spirit's guidance, and your touch on their lives, Lord, that they would feel fruitful and fulfilled in all that you call them to do and be. And we ask it in the name of our Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And everybody said, amen, amen. You may be seated. And if we could walk around, and I like each one to get a nice fist bump. We're not shaking hands yet, but we can give a, come on around, board and staff and ladies. Yeah. Thank you, June. Appreciate you sharing that. We are truly brothers and sisters. We like to talk about how we are family. And appreciate our Orchard Beach family and every one of you. And June was just reminding me, her son Dave, it's been 1 year today of battling cancer. Has been battling cancer, and it's been 1 year. And we're going to offer prayer together for Dave. If you would just bow your head. Father, thank you for Dave and your involvement in his life. And we ask today, as a family, for your blessing over him, your continued touch, that you'd raise him up, you'd give him a testimony to share. Comfort him, Lord, in these days, and the family that surrounds him, we pray. Amen. Amen. Really do. I have a family, you know. We're all just real people. I have a wife and I have 5 kids. And this church family has been there for me through a lot of ups and a lot of downs. So there's been some good and some bad and some ugly. But you're family to us. And we really, really value that. And thank you. For all your love and your grace. We want everyone to experience that. We want everyone in our community to have that sort of support and love and guidance in their life. That's just our heartbeat, and we appreciate it. I just want to give a shout out also to our board members and their wives, their sacrificial service. We meet every month, and I just feel strengthened by them and by their leadership, their servant-hearted leadership. And I wonder if we could just give them a hand of appreciation today, our board members and our wives. This is in no way, in any sense of a power or anything. We just love each other in Christ, and we appreciate that. And related to family and the dynamics of how we're talking about marriage. This is week 4 of what every family needs. And we've been talking about how that is to model the love of Christ for the church. Jesus is the head. The church is the body. He is the head, and the church submits to the head. And marriage is to be a picture of that, where Christ, the husband, is the head, and the wife, as the church, submits to the head. And if that pushes your buttons, you're going to need to listen to last week so it can kind of set you at ease about what submission really is. But it's a picture of the church. and the cooperation that there is and the unity that comes into one body. And in marriage, again, is one body, just as Christ and his body come together. That's what a picture of what marriage is intended to be. And we're giving that direction through God's word. So we've been looking at what every family needs through the book of Colossians. Okay, we're just walking through book by book. And Colossians is a short letter written by the Apostle Paul, who was a dirtbag sinner at one point in his life. He liked to persecute Christians. Well, then he got saved. He met Jesus. His life changed. He ends up in prison for sharing Jesus so much. And then he hears about this small church in Colossae that's struggling while he's in prison. So while in prison for his faith, he gets news about this little church in Colossae made of people just like us trying to figure out faith. And unfortunately, that church was plagued with false teachers. They're all over the place. We got to stick to the word. Well, false teachers were devaluing the importance and the supremacy of Christ in all things. And Paul was trying to bring back the influence of focusing on Christ and following Christ alone for everything that they needed. And so we're in chapter 3 right now, verse 18, 19 is where we are. But so far, this is what he's talked about. We talked about our identity. We are ministers of Jesus Christ. That's who we really are. Every one of us that have come to faith in Christ, we are ministers of Jesus Christ. And then in this series, what every family needs, first we talked about a solid foundation. And we had literally a brick out here. You remember the brick? Because Jesus said, anyone who hears my words and puts them into practice is like a man who builds on a rock. So when the storms come and the rain falls and the floods come up, you're solid. You're going to be okay. We talked about how my family's going to be okay when we do things God's way. So the first thing every family needs is a solid foundation. And what we know that is Jesus' words. We hear his words and we put them into practice. We have a solid foundation. I mentioned this before, but I'm tempted to think in today's culture, man, our kids don't have a chance. That's a lie from the enemy. We build on a solid foundation. He promises we're going to be okay. And then we talked about how you not only need a solid foundation, but you need a new wardrobe. And we had a rack of clothes out here. And he talked about how there's certain things in our life now that we've come to Christ, we take off. And new things that we put on. And he talks about it in the context of clothing, but that's what he's talking about, taking off sexual sins, deception sins. What was the other one? Anger sins. Somebody remembered that. Very good. We take those off and we put on love, gentleness, kindness, humility. And the purpose of what Paul is saying is, when you build on a solid foundation and Christ is supreme in your home is going to be different. Things at home change. Your life at home with your husband, your wife, and your children are going to be radically different. That's the point he's trying to make. Your life is going to be different, and it begins in the home. So two things the family needs, a solid foundation and a new wardrobe. We talked about how Christ makes us into new things as we worship him and as we're in his word. And then the third thing we started last week on top of the foundation and the wardrobe is an operations manual. Everybody knows, or everybody wishes, when we have kids, I wish having kids came with a manual. Or I wish, you know, getting married came with a manual. Well, we have one, and it's God's word. And Paul begins to share now the operations manual for the home. So this is beyond the church family. This is right in the home. And he writes very specific things to each member of the household. Last week we said he started with the wives. You remember what he said to wives? Wives, that was so weak and no one really wants to say that ugly bad word. Wives, submit to your husbands as The church submits to Christ. And you do it in honor to Christ. So, like I said, if that kind of pushes your buttons, you have to watch last week. I'm not going to review it. The next thing that he says, he speaks directly to husbands. So last week was happy husband, happy home. Today is happy wife, happy life. So this is what he says specifically to husbands. This is your God-given divine role as a husband. Husbands, love your wives. Husbands, love your wives. Love them. That's what he's saying. This is your role. Your God-given duty is to love your wives. That's how he says it, starting in verse 19. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Happy wife, happy life. And then in Ephesians, we get more information. What is he talking about? What does that look like? Ephesians chapter 5, 25, we get more detail for the husbands. Here we go. Husbands, love your wives. It's the same guy writing to a different church, same thing. Love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. So you can see, just as the work of Christ to make us holy, to change us into the likeness of Christ, the husband's role is to love the wife in such a way that she becomes more like Christ. That she becomes all that God intends for her to become. I got to love her that much that it changes her into the likeness of Christ. In the same way, says husbands, ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated his own body, but they feed and care for their body, just as Christ does the church. For we are members of his body. So you get the picture again. Marriage is to be a model of the love of Christ for the church. The love of husband is to be love like Christ to his wife. Here's what he's really saying. Men, if you want joy and you want happiness in life, you lay your life down. That's what he's saying. That's what Christ did for the church. He gave his life for the church. So in marriage, a relationship, if you want happiness and joy in life, you lay your life down first to Christ, and then if you're married, to your wife. Because here's the truth, and I promise it's true. If you live your life selfishly, you're never going to be happy. Joy really comes from giving your life away. We all know that deep down. When a person says he or she has a happy marriage, you know what they're really saying? Their needs are being met. Hey, I have a happy marriage. What does that mean? Well, my needs are being met. That's what a happy marriage means. And God designed men and women to have different needs. We talked last week about the husband's needs. We're going to look today at three primary needs of wives that God designed for husbands to meet. And here's the truth. The only way you can meet these needs is to lay your life down. That's the way. Is to lay your life down. This is the overriding principle for today, to meet her needs. To love her as Christ loves the church, you need to lay your life down. What did Jesus do? He died for the church. So let's understand this. The wife gets to submit, and the husband gets to die. Okay? That might be a little bit different twist than you grew up with. The husband is the boss, and the wife submits. No, that's not what Scripture says. Scripture says the wife gets to submit, the husband gets to die. And we lay our lives down. Specifically, we're going to talk about three primary needs of wives. And I'm borrowing heavily from my good brother Robert Morris today. But number one need of every wife is communication. And all the ladies said? Yeah. Hey, I don't know about you, but I'm a guy. I'm a man of few words. I tend to be the guy that likes to sit in the back and listen and take notes. I don't like to be up front, and I'm not a gabber. I'm not great at communication. In fact, as I'm studying this message for myself, I'm feeling like I got a lot of work to do. I got a lot of work to do as a husband loving my wife. I'm naturally quiet, but I got to lay my life down. They need communication. And I can help you guys with just one little thing here today. This is going to be helpful, trust me. When you get married, there's a word you can drop from your vocabulary. And it's the word fine. Everybody say fine? Fine. How was your day? Fine. How are you feeling? Fine. That won't work, okay? Ladies don't want the headlines and they don't want the bottom line. They want the entire story. It's a need. They have communication. You know, when Rhonda and I were first married and we got married, I would come home and she would immediately start on me. That's the way I viewed it. I felt interrogated, untrusted, bombarded with a barrage of questions about the day, to the point of feeling like I might say something wrong here and get myself in trouble. That's coming up. That's coming up. That's coming up. Wives, submit to your husbands. Thank you very much. Husbands, love your wives. You know, Satan's in a battle for our families. Actually, he loves destroying marriages and kids. And God has given an operations manual that works if we'll do it. So I would feel bombarded, barraged, all these questions. Where were you? Where'd you go? Who were you with? Who'd you see? What did you say? What did they say? Why did it take you so long? And here's what I thought. She's the nosiest person on the planet. Because a guy would have said, how was your day? And I would have said, and it would have been fine. We would have moved on and done our own thing, and all would have been happy. But not Rhonda. It doesn't work, okay? And I still struggle with this. She'll tell you. Once again, love is to lay our life down. And this is a need women have. She needs to communicate with us. And listen, it's the way that they connect with us. It's a way that they connect. And I had never thought of this before, and I didn't get this from Robert. The Lord shared this with me. The relationship of the Christ and the church, the desperate need of the church to pray, to be connected. The wife has a desperate need to communicate. The church dies without prayer. And so God designed it this way. I didn't realize this. I just thought she was being overbearing. But she needed to communicate. Whether I thought it was important or not. Whether I thought the question was a good one or not. Whether I thought the question had any relevance to anything going on. I'm still trying. And this is big. If you can add the word feel to your conversation, big points, okay? Big points, because women love feelings. Women love feelings. Guys aren't wired like that, though. We just aren't. But ladies fall in love with you when you can mention feelings. And because you weren't wired that way, guys, for a while, you might just have to make some things up. Because ladies, when you say to your husband, how do you feel about that? And he says, I don't know. He's not lying. We're not connected to our feelings that way. You know, one guy had been married for 25 years and he was selling his company that he led for 20 years. He's selling his company after 20 years. And she said to him, how do you feel about selling your company? You know, he says, I don't know. And she said, well, are you upset? And he said, no. You know what she said? Yes, you are. And later he said, you know what? The more I thought about it, I was upset. I was quite upset about that. But that's not the way that we think. We don't attach our feelings. And here's the reason why. Men come from the factory emotionally unassembled. We have all the wires, but they're not connected. She was helping her husband connect the wires between selling his company and how he felt. And that's one of the natural things that can happen in a marriage relationship. You help connect the wires. And men, if you'll start talking, you can begin to get all wired up. And in that, and I believe this is true, you begin to get wired up to your feelings. That can actually aid not only in connection to your wife, but in connection to your Heavenly Father. So one thing wives do just kind of naturally is help connect our wires to our feelings. And when that happens, we can, in a more deep and different way sometimes, connect with our Heavenly Father. So if you'll lay your life down, you're meeting a need, you'll have a happy wife. And you'll have a happy life. Affairs are never justified. But you know why men and women have affairs? Men have affairs because, we talked about this last week, men have affairs because a woman will honor him and give him sex. That's why men have affairs. Women have affairs because men will listen to them and connect. That's why they have affairs. And by the way, to the ladies, there are men out there who will pretend to listen so they can get sex. But that's the way we're wired. So guys, women need communication. Happy wife, happy life. The second thing, a major need that wives need, is leadership. Some may say, no, I don't. Yes, you do. The number one complaint that I hear in all marriage, I've been doing this approaching 30 years now. The number one complaint most wives had is my husband won't lead. He won't get it done. He won't take the initiative. And leadership is not about domination. No person wants to be dominated. No person, male or female, wants to be dominated. And actually, research will tell you that the most destructive homes is where there is a person that dominates. When you have a dominant person in that house, it's one of the most destructive environments that you can have. So no woman wants to be dominated, but wives want their husbands to lead. Here's a definition. Leadership is not domination, it's initiation. Leadership is initiation. That's the way God is with us. He initiates. You're driving down the road one day, or you're in your private time, and all of a sudden God speaks into this. He prompts you to go this way. He sets something up, you know, during the day. Something got arranged. It had to be him. God initiates leadership. He's the leader in your life. And think about this. We are supposed to lead our wives the way Christ leads the church. Guys, can you imagine if you went to the Lord for leadership and he led you the way that you lead her? If he was dominating and he put you down, he didn't speak to you, or he was critical, would you want a leader like that? Or what if he was an absent leader? What if you went to him and said, God, what do you think about this? And what do you think about that? And he says, I don't know. Lord, should I take this job transfer? Beats me. See, that's not God. And God gives us leadership. And that's all she wants. She wants us to take leadership in the home. Not domination, but initiation. To be helpful. God designed it that way. Here are three ways that I think every woman wants to be led. Number one, they want to be led in spiritual matters. They want somebody that will say, we're going to church. I'll pick it. This is the one. Let's go. They want someone to take the lead spiritually in their lives. Second way I think they want to be led in spiritual matters is through prayer. And I get it. I know. I think it's one of the most difficult things sometimes for a husband to pray with your wife because it makes you so vulnerable and being authentic. But I'm going to guarantee you, some of you are going to would say, well, I'm not good at prayer. I just don't pray, or I don't like, I just, it's not my thing, or I don't even know how. Trust me, she would appreciate your poor praying over no praying. She would. She wants leadership in spiritual matters. You remember Adam and Eve? Who was the first one to take the bite? Eve. And the big question God had, he shouted down from heaven, where are you? To Adam. Where were you? When she was ready to take that bite, where were you? I think sometimes God says that to husbands today in the family. Where are you? In spiritual matters, where you could have prevented something, initiated something, gone a different way. Leadership is initiation. They want leadership in spiritual matters. They do. Second area women want leadership is with the kids. And all the lady said, she wants leadership when it comes to the kids. You know, right now, one of my sons is excited about pursuing getting a vehicle. I guarantee you, Rhonda wants me to initiate taking leadership and walking him through that. Discipline. Discipline. If she's alone in all the disciplining of the kids, that's not good for the kids. Not that she shouldn't be involved and that she shouldn't discipline, but she shouldn't be the leader. That's why my mom would always say, you just wait till your father gets home. Because my dad was a leader. He'd lead us right to the bedroom with a belt. He taught, and he was a leader. You never disrespect your mother. Never disrespect your mother. He was a leader. This week I saw a post on Facebook, Sarah Duncan. It's a guy sleeping on a hospital floor. They had a sick child, very young. He works in concrete, 12-hour days, 6 days a week. Kid needed to go to the hospital. She's like, I know you're wiped, you're too tired, just stay home, I'll take care of this. He said, no, you're not going to do this alone. This is what she wrote in her Facebook post. Let's talk about this because it doesn't get enough attention. What some may see, a dad sleeping while mom stays awake holding their sleeping baby in the ER at 2 a.m. What I see, a dad sleeping on the hard floor of the ER after working 12-hour shifts 6 days a week for at least a month, despite the fact his wife asked him to stay home and rest, all because he didn't want his babies to be alone in the hospital. because he didn't want his wife to have to do it on her own, no matter how exhausted he is. And she writes this: this is what love is. This is what being a husband is. This is what being a daddy is. And I wouldn't want to do this life with anyone else. Thank you for all you do for us, Daddy. We love you. Why doesn't she want to do life with anyone else? Because he's meeting her need. Leadership in the home. Wives want their husbands to lead in spiritual matters and with the kids. And then the third area wives want their husbands to lead is in romance. Now, I may look very romantic, okay? I may look like I'm probably the romantic type. I was sharing with Rhonda, preparing for this. I said, I feel like I'm probably one of the least romantic type people. You know what she says? Her immediately thought went to, well, you should have had Paul Kitchen come up and share something. That's what she said. I mean, Paul set the bar too high. All of you that are in their life group, you know what I'm talking about. He sets the bar high on that. I'm convinced, guys, we are never more like Christ than when we are loving our wife. Wives, I don't believe you're any more, ever more like Christ than when you're submitting to your husband. See, that's marriage. It's designed to make us more like Christ. God set it up that way. He's given us an operations manual. I guarantee you, she doesn't want to have to remind you about the anniversary and the birthdays. Let's give a definition. Romance is meeting a need before it's spoken. Think of that. Romance is meeting a need before it's spoken. So if I initiate meeting a need before it's spoken, things in the Keith home are good that night. I know she's not a big flower person. She just hasn't been a flower person. She likes peanut M&Ms, Dairy Queen, hot fudge milkshakes, extra thick, and cherry licorice. She also likes the fragrance called Happy. She likes the fragrance called Happy. So she gets a bottle of Happy, happy wife, happy life. And here's the point. Husbands, your God-given role is to love, and that involves leading. Your wife wants you to lead in spiritual matters, with the kids, and in romance. So, three needs husbands are called to meet: communication, leadership, and the third one's the biggest one, the biggest need a wife has is security. Think this through. What is the most profound, satisfying thing Jesus says to the church? I'll never leave you or forsake you. How many times have you gone back to that in your mind in difficult seasons? He said he will never leave me or forsake me. That security, the love of Christ to the church. You're safe with me. Security is her number one need. And you need to know, if you can't talk to her in ways that make her feel secure, she's not going to hear a word you say. Just like last week we talked about, if you speak to him in a dishonoring way, he doesn't hear a word you say. Everything just shuts off. If you're going to dishonor me, I don't even hear it. That's the way a wife is with security. If you can't speak in terms that give security, she shuts down. Everything shuts down. The number one need is security. And what do I mean? Guys, you always speak to her in terms of I'm always going to be here. I'm going to do my best to love you like Christ loves the church. I've got this covered. I'm going to take care of this. When you wake up tomorrow, I'm going to be here. I'm going to lay my life down for you. I'm going to do whatever it takes to make sure you are taken care of. I'm not going anywhere. That's security. That's loving your wife as Christ loves the church. And happy wife, happy life. Rhonda and I, we've been married 21 years. 21 years. We freely shared our first at least five were challenging. But you know, she never had to worry about money. You know why? Rhonda has never needed to worry about being evicted from our apartment or having her vehicle repossessed or worry about the kids having food or new clothes to go to school. You know why she's never had to worry about that? Because she has a hardworking, dependable, faithful, good-looking husband. Financial security. Now, we both work, but it's my responsibility. We're supposed to lay our lives down for our wives. And I agree with Robert Morris when he says this. He says, as a pastor, I'm concerned about the next generation. I'm very concerned. One of the things I'm concerned about is our kids. They're getting married later and later in life. If you are in your late 20s or early 30s and not married, don't hear this in any way condemning at all, but also listen, though, to see if anything might kind of ring a bell to some of your friends. There may be three reasons kids are getting married much later today. Number one is fear. Many have a fear of failure when it comes to marriage. I mean, look at the statistics. They say it's not really too much in your favor of being successful. But again, listen, if you do it according to the manual, you can have 100% success rate. 100% when both people work according to the manual. You're going to see it through. This is how Rhonda and I made it. I'll tell you flat out. We made it through some very dark seasons. We decided to do it his way. I lay my life down. I submit. And if you're a divorce, no condemnations in any way, I understand it. We all here understand the dynamics of all that's involved. But I guarantee you, whenever there has been a divorce, it's because at least one person didn't do it according to God's word. You don't have to live by fear. You can live by faith. The second reason, I think, so many young people wait so long is just flat-out selfishness. They don't want to lay their lives down. I don't want to do that. They want what they want when they want it. They want to have the freedom to go here and there and do whatever. They don't want to lay their lives down. And then maybe the third reason why they wait so long is just immaturity. Rhonda's like, I was married and taking care of a family when I was 18. If you didn't know, she lost her first husband. But a lot of people are so immature. Today we have a whole lot of 25 and 30-year-old boys. Because the difference between a boy and a man is a man can take care of a family. And women want that. They want that. Too many guys are seriously content to just have enough money for pizza and video games. And here's the truth for the guys. You don't have to be the provider. God's the provider. You just have to be a hard worker. If you're a hard worker, God will take care of the rest. Be a hard worker and a good steward. And if you're a single, right now, you start saving for that. You don't wait till you find somebody. You start saving now so you're prepared to take care and add security to that family. Every wife needs to have security. You know, as I said, in our early years, Rhonda had a lot of emotional trauma to wade through. Death of her husband, alcoholism in her biological family. She was a single mom. I come back to that, I was battling selfishness of being single for 33 years. That's all I knew, is to think of me. That's all I knew. So we were wading through all of that. At times I felt like, with all the questioning, sometimes I really felt like she was trying to prove that I didn't love her. Just kind of push you away. No matter what I did, I'm going to prove that you don't love me. It was just trauma, dealing with everything that had been going on. Really, she was needing to feel secure. Man, that took me way too long to figure out. Way too long to figure out. She was needing me to lead in feeling secure. After a while, the lights kind of went on. Communication, leadership, security. I pounded it home. Hey, you can push me away all you want. I'm not going anywhere. I'm in this. I'm committed. I'm all in. I love you. I'm going to lay my life down for you. Do you know why we love Jesus? Think about this. It's not because he sits in a recliner and barks orders. It's because he left heaven and laid his life down for us. That's why we love him. That's what Jesus did, and that's why we love him. And that's why he tells husbands, love your wives. Would you bow your head, close your eyes? Father, thank you for your word. It's true. Thank you for the operations manual. And thank you, Lord, for your desire to be helpful and not harmful. We thank you, Lord, in our weakness, you show yourself strong. We thank you, Lord, when it feels like there's no hope with you, it's like taking another drink out of the fountain. Oh, you're so good. Teach us, Lord, to drink from the fountain, to drink every day from your word, to be in your house, to be around other believers, to be filled up, to be what you want us to be. Thank you, Holy Spirit, again, through speaking through your word. Help us, Lord, today, especially the guys, the husbands. Lord, we know your calling is to love like you love the church. Would you help us in our communication, in our leadership, in giving security? Let this be our hallmarks, because we know, Lord, as we do this, we are like Christ. And Lord, I want to thank you also for models like Paul Kitchen and other men who raise the bar, that call us to be more like Christ. Bless them. Lead us. Guide us. Be with each one as they go today, Father. Give them peace in their minds, joy in their hearts, strength in their faith. I pray in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. If you would like prayer before you go, we're available up here for prayer. Other than that, God bless you. See you next week. Next week, we talk about the kids. If you understand raising kids today is a challenge, it could be a good time to be here next week. We hope you come back. God bless.